UnleashIndependence.com.
All right. Thank you for tuning in again for another broadcast of Unleash Independence Radio. We have a very special guest. I want to welcome on, first off, my co-host, Brock J. Thanks for joining us.
Awesome. I'm excited. Thanks for bringing us on, Kim.
Absolutely. And then we have a guest who's been on our show before, Micah Miller.
Hey, Cameron. Thanks so much for having me. I'm really excited to be here.
And our special guest, Josh Rubin from EastWest Healing. Is that right?
Yeah. Thanks for having me on.
Absolutely. Well, Josh, the first question I want to pose to you is, why is it important to challenge the information that we are given? Why should we seek out and do our own research when it comes to health and wellness? I think a lot of people think, you know, I'm not a doctor. This doctor has gone to school for so long or whatever. You know, why is it important to do your own research?
I think there's a lot of factors involved in that, and I'm just going to give you my take on it. You know, it doesn't mean it's right, because I always tell everyone, don't believe anything I say. Don't believe anything anyone says. Challenge everyone, not in a negative way. But, you know, fortunately, we have the internet. It's great. The unfortunate thing is we also have Google University. So you have all this stuff out there that maybe it's correct, maybe it's incorrect. You know, there's no one really editing it to say it's right or wrong. And you have all these people out there developing forums. You have everyone out there doing YouTubes. There's no regulations. And you have everyone, blogging. And it's dangerous because a lot of these people that have web businesses that blog and YouTube, they have all these followers, and then they want to start, you know, helping people. But my thing is, how can you help people when it comes to health when all you do is blog, you write about it, you do a YouTube about it? It doesn't make sense to me. It'd be like me going, I'm going to write a blog or do a YouTube or write an ebook on how to fix an engine. I don't fix engines, though. You know, maybe if I did it well enough, people would believe me. Of course they would. You post it online, most people are going to believe you. So I think you need to really do your own research. Not to say you discredit anyone, but take what someone says, do a little bit more research on it, and really find if it works for you. And I think that's the second point. There's so much out there. I believe there's only one way. It's really based on human anatomy and human physiology, because you can't argue. You can't argue it. You know, this muscle does this. You know, this joint does this. Of course, there's variations. I'm talking functionality, not dysfunction. So, going back to my second point, which I kind of forget, is I forget what I was saying. But you know, it's really finding the right information for you. So research something, and if you don't get a good vibe from it, and it doesn't seem right, it might have worked for a million people, but it's going to be right for you. You know, it's like some people like Christianity and some people don't. It doesn't matter that people don't like it. If it works for you and it serves you, that's all that really matters. Same thing with nutrition and working with someone for health. You've got to find the right practitioner that vibrates with you. You've got to find the right practitioner that has information and has done the research and has had the experience. And you feel that it's the right fit on all levels, mentally, emotionally, physically, etc. And I think we have to do the research because we've got to work with people that have experience. Success is not based on how much money you make. It's not how many clients you have. But to me, that means absolutely nothing. I mean, so many trainers that go, I've been in the industry for 15 years. That means absolutely jack squat to me. And I know people that have been in the nutrition industry for 2 years, really don't even have a certification, but they've helped tons of people. So for me, experience is how many people you're actually educating and helping, and helping people create their own journey. So I think it's important to work with someone that has the experience, that has the success, and that's willing to listen to you, that's willing to educate you. That's another key point. We like to educate our clients. And I think instead of telling someone what to do, it's educating them so you don't work with them forever. So I think there's a lot of factors involved on why you need to do your own research. The bottom line is you need to make it work for you so you can work with someone that helps you create your own journey. So many practitioners are into turning their clients into them. You can't do this, you can't do this, you can't do that. But you can do this principle, and this principle. That's textbook. You're basically turning your – go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, you know, when you touch on principles, that's what we really like to focus on, because there are so many different variations, no matter what we're talking about, what aspect of life, you know, whether it's, a religious mind and spirit aspect or health, like we're discussing today. You know, the principle seems to kind of be fluid between these aspects of life. So How did you get started? What are some of the principles that you adopted early on?
Well, you know, we all learn later. So initially I got my degree in occupational therapy, worked in rehab, and was disillusioned by what I could do and couldn't do and how no was getting better. And I really wanted to study the body more. So I got involved with NASM and NCA, you know, all those things, and started training. And, you know, from there moved on to Charles Pollock and Paul Check, and just started, you know, studying on my own and reading, going through all their stuff, and, you know, teaching for the Czech Institute all over the world. And then I got introduced to Chinese medicine, moved to that realm for a little bit, went to Chinese medicine school. You know, and I do a lot of reading on my own, even though I have a lot of these certifications. I got an office full of books. I just love to read. So I have a lot of great authors, and then I got tuned into osteopathy, more out of the States, osteopathy, true osteopathy, and studying the body. And, you know, back in 2006, I think it was, or 5, got introduced to the work Ray Peat, and that really changed my view, because one of the big things we really, when we talk about principles, so many people out there are promoting diets or systems based on dysfunction. All they do is study dysfunction. For us, we study human physiology and anatomy, and our system's based on function. So for me, when it comes to nutrition, I really don't believe in, like, oh, drink half your body weight in ounces a day. Everyone should sleep from 10 o'clock at night till 6 in the morning. To me, that's generalizing everyone, and everyone is completely different. So I like looking at the person that's in front of me and saying, what are the pieces to their healing puzzle? What are the principles I might use for that person that's in front of me? Because it's going to be different for every single person that we work with. Like a lady I talked to this morning, you know, everyone says eczema is a symptom of candida. Well, it's really not. We like to, like, pinpoint, you know, to give some direction, and everyone has a diet based on candida. But if we understand function, what candida is, it's really not the problem. And if we understand hormones and physiology, we understand why we get eczema. But everyone says it's candida. Well, come to find out, their kid had it because of the detergent they were using. And all they had to do was eliminate the detergent. So once again, principles need to be individualized. So for me, it was, you know, I've had a lot of different mentors, the ones I really mentioned. But for me, the one that made the largest impact in my life, in regards to my business, I'd say back in the day, was Paul Check when I caught for them. I've kind of moved on from him and them, and really have, you know, since 2006 been studying Ray Peat in human physiology. And that's kind of like the what I truly believe in, because, you know, he talks about physiology. You know, he's done his own research. No one really does that. Everyone writes books based on other books. So it's really not their information, where a lot of his stuff is his own clinical experience. And to me,
you know, Ray Peat was someone that I was introduced to a few years back by Micah, who's on with us right now. Micah, I want to bring you on, too. If you have any questions, feel free to jump in real quick. But
yeah, great.
You know, Ray Peat is interesting. I really liked what he has to say, but it's completely outside of the norm. And, you know, I'm a little bit attracted to that type of stuff. But, I mean, ice cream and all the stuff that we're told, this is bad, you know, sugar is bad. And yet that seems to be a big staple of his diet. I don't know if
well,
you can touch on that a bit.
Yeah, I will touch on it, because I think that's where the confusion sets in. Because you have people reading intense articles that don't understand physiology. And that's an obnoxious statement. But when I was introduced to him, I think it was like 2004 even, I started to read his work, and I'm like, this is like going against everything I know. But I didn't understand his articles because I didn't fully understand physiology. But the more I understood physiology, it's like you start to see, you know, those books, Find Waldo. You start to see Waldo. You start to see the music in what he's writing, you know, the beauty of it. And unfortunately, this is one of my big hang-ups, a huge hang-up, and it really rubs me the wrong way. So if you hear frustration in my voice, it's frustration. You have all these people creating these forums. You have all these people promoting that Ray Peat says you should eat ice cream, you should eat marshmallows, you should eat sugar, you should eat chocolate. It's completely incorrect. It's 100% completely incorrect. He does not promote that stuff. He might use it as an example, but he doesn't promote it. He even says it in his article. I don't know exact article. It's in our Metabolic Blueprint program. We talk about it. And I talked to him at length about these things. Sugar. When he uses the word sugar, 99% of the time he's talking about the chemistry aspect of sucrose. We say carbohydrates. He says sugars. Now, I'm not saying he doesn't advocate the use of sugar. But I talked to him about this. He really only recommends it in certain cases because it is sucrose, just like you can get sucrose in fruit. He recommends people using it if they're comfortable in the winter when you really can't get ripe fruit and you can't get a lot of fruit. In order to regulate energy metabolism, in the winter when it's cold, you need more thyroid, you need more T3. And that's one way to increase T3 production. It's with sucrose, glucose, and fructose. Now, he recommends only using it for a short period of time, and at the same time, he recommends it with especially women. Let's say I've been working with someone for a long time and been fine-tuning their foods and ratios and grams and looking at things, and we're really trying everything over like a 6 to 8 month period. We're not getting a budge in temperatures. You know, before trying a glandular or having a lab test, to try to get more sucrose or sugar into their day without adding more food because they just can't eat more, we can increase carbohydrate ratio and possibly upregulate thyroid metabolism. So he really doesn't recommend the use of it every day. He recommends the use of root vegetables and fruits, which are sugars. You know, all these other foods are non-foods. There's not much nutrient value to them. I mean, he uses them as examples. But everyone that I've ever worked with, that's worked with these other practitioners that promote the use of those foods, come to me so overweight and so unhappy, and they really haven't made much progress. So for me, it's about eating the right types of carbohydrates, fruits and roots. It's about eating the right types of non-inflammatory proteins, right types of fats. I don't recommend any of my clients use ice cream, chocolate, marshmallows, cheesecakes, custards, or ice cream. None of them. Actually, if they're on them, I tell them to go off them. The only time I'll tell them to use sugars like those foods is if you're in a bind. Hey, you're going on a 4-hour flight. Maybe take some dark chocolate with you. If you don't want to take some food with you, you know, and put it through the x-ray machine. You know, you're going on a hike and you can't take food with you, maybe take some marshmallows, which is sugar and gelatin. So you use them when needed. You don't use them all the time because there's not much nutrient value to them. So for me, I don't believe that's what he's promoting. I believe he promotes the right types of proteins, carbs, and fats versus sugars, ice cream, and stuff like that. But going back to what you said, you know, his stuff is against the grain, but it's against the grain because it's really talking about the function of the body. And it's looking at the body as a system of systems and not pulling apart one system and saying, okay, this is the problem. Like unsaturated fat. You know, our society says, well, you know, omega-3 fatty acids, essential fatty acids are anti-inflammatory. So I'm going to pull that research, and we're going to start promoting unsaturated fats or essential fatty acids because they're anti-inflammatory. That's what it showed. That's what it showed. And that's what in the body it does. It is anti-inflammatory, but in very tiny, tiny amounts. We produce our own unsaturated fats, omega-9 fatty acids, from sugars. We do this in homeostasis, so we don't need essential fatty acids. When you take them, you downregulate specific enzymes to produce your omega-9. So you actually downregulate your own system from producing your own anti-inflammatory fats. So society takes this and says, shit, I can make a shitload of money, but we're not going to do any research on what are some of the downfalls of taking in too many unsaturated fats.
Oh, yeah. I need to butt in here for a second and just say I agree with you so much on that. It's funny because, like you said, people, they get this, they say unsaturated fatty acids are anti-inflammatory, yes, but in very small amounts. And then there's all this bogus science, or actually I wouldn't call it science, which people use to say that saturated fats are, in fact, bad and unhealthy and contribute to heart disease, even though there's really no credence to that whatsoever. It's kind of something that's been put forward and it's believed. And because of that, you go to the market and you look on the shelf and you have a jug of heart-healthy, quote, corn oil that's high in polyunsaturated, fats. It's like a just pure polyunsaturated oil. And people then think that's healthy, and our entire food supply is inundated with it. And people wonder why heart disease is going up. It's because we're doing what the doctors tell us to do. We're decreasing saturated fat intake and increasing polyunsaturated fat intake, which is what's causing the inflammation in the arteries.
How's your understanding on that, Josh? Is Blanca right on?
Yeah.
Oh, you know, Josh, I'm having a hard time getting you, hearing you. Are you there?
Yeah, I think we're losing him.
Okay. So what you're talking about, Micah, let me just, Josh, when you get to a spot where you can hear us again, you know, hey, Brock, are you on?
Yeah, I'm on. One question I was going to ask him, and hopefully I can ask him later on, because I see so many people with a thyroid issue, and I'd like to ask him what, from his research, what is the cause of the people having it, because it seems like it's an outbreak. Like, I swear, like 15 years ago, you didn't know that many people with a thyroid issue, and now it's like crazy. So I'd like to know what his take on the actual chemical or whatever you want to call it is causing the thyroid, and then obviously it's not cookie cutter for everyone, but what things people can research to find out how to fix their thyroid problem.
Right. And another thing, too, I'm going to ring through, so hopefully this doesn't show up on air. I'm going to try and get him again. And then I'm going to go into the screening room, so maybe you two can talk about it. But for those people that are unaware of what, like, a polyunsaturated fat is or saturated fat, maybe if you can go into that, I'll be in the screening room trying to get Josh back on.
Yeah, we got to get him back on here. You gonna call him, Cameron?
Yeah, he's actually switching over right now to the little room so he can call. So, Micah, so like, what got you into this? Like, I was talking to my dad the other day, and he's like, he tries supplements out, or he tries a certain food, and if he goes, if I don't feel something, he's like, I'm not gonna discredit it, but it just seems like it's not working for me. So, I guess what made you, feel a certain thing, in terms of like Ray Peat.
Man, it all started. It was probably about 3 years ago, 3 or 4 years ago actually. I can't even really tell you how it started. I remember I started at first it was supplements.
Hey,
I started because I like to. Yeah, what's going on?
Hey, sorry to cut off. We don't have too much time with Josh, and I got him back on, so I just wanted to bring him right back into where we left off.
Yeah, well, sure. We should give him some more time. Go ahead and put him on.
Yeah, I completely agree with the last thing we're talking about. And this goes back to the first question. I think everyone in our society, well, not everyone, but I think most people get their needs met through other people. Most people don't think for themselves. And that's the problem. Most people walk around with a brain on a leash. So if a doctor says this is healthy, if it's on the shelf, we think it's healthy. Why would they sell something that's unhealthy? And it's we can talk science, but it's common sense. I mean, you go to the grocery store, you pick up a box, you look at the ingredients, you can't pronounce half the ingredients. Why the hell would you put it in your body? You know, and I think when it comes to health, all we have to do is look out the window and say, is it really working for us? And it's really not. And in order to get healthy, you just do the opposite of what you're doing. So when it comes to the unsaturated fats, I think it's a huge moneymaker. And no one's doing research on the negative impact on anything. Everyone's doing the research on the benefit, and most of the research is paid for. So all I can say is I used to be a proponent of fish oils and all that. But the results that we've gotten over the past 5, 6, 7 years using this philosophy, which is nutrition based on human physiology, which is Ray's approach, we've gotten 10 million times better results with clients all over the world using just food, hardly any supplements, hardly any labs, in reducing unsaturated fats. You know, so I think people just have to ask the question why. You know, saturated fats really bad? And if they are we talking about coconut oil? Are we talking about saturated fat that's in steak from crappy cows? You know, people just are not thinking. They're just like sheep. They're just going around and you know, they're saying, well, I'm not going to buy organic because it's too expensive. You know, it's what they're really saying is I don't care about myself. I mean, to say food is too expensive, you're basically saying I don't really care about my health. You know, it's the most important thing that's going to keep you alive. And
it's really interesting that you put it that way. We had, you know, someone come on. We were talking about food. You know, I mentioned that I did a little bit of research about just a place that sells really good beef around my place, and I compared it to Walmart. Now, it was actually a little bit cheaper to buy the healthy stuff. It was not as convenient. I had to drive about 35 miles to get it. But, you know, I think it is out there. Brock, you had a really good question that I wanted to get in before Josh had to go.
Yeah, Josh, it seems like there's like an outbreak of, you're talking about the thyroid problem, and I've done a little bit of research on hormones, but nowhere near what you have. So I'd like to ask, like, I mean, what's the cause of all these thyroid problems in the last 20 years, it seems? And then what, I know it's not cookie cutter, but like, what's something people can research to find out something for themselves?
Well, just FYI, if we go 5-10 minutes over, it's not the end of the world.
Okay.
If you feel like, you're rushed. You know, for me, I like using the word hypometabolic versus hypothyroid because I'm not a doctor. I can't diagnose people. And too many people, I believe, when they're diagnosed, emotionally, they're walking around with this red tag around their neck saying I'm defective. So hypometabolic, I just like the term better because it's something we can work on, and we can see that with people's body temperature and pulse. So when it comes to the thyroid, you know, you can study the work of Broda Barnes. He was the one, like the MD that, you know, brought, in my opinion, you know, the thyroid and the body in itself into the medical industry. There's other people like Philip Young, of course, Ray Peat, you know, Hans Hillier, McGavick. But Broda Barnes is probably the simplest one for most listeners. So the interesting thing about the thyroid is, if you think about like an orchestra, you have a conductor, and you have different sections of the orchestra, just like the human body. So most diets, in my opinion, focus on fixing the body from the outside in, just like most therapies. I'm going to crack this, I'm going to stretch this, I'm going to fix this. Instead, this is why I like Ray's philosophy, because to me it's like the way true osteopaths think. It's healing the body from the inside out, listening to the body. The body tells you what to do based on function, what's not working, and you do the appropriate techniques to create autoregulation, because the body's telling you that. Same thing with the thyroid. So if you look at the thyroid, it's, in a sense, our cells are the conductor of everything in the body. The cells have two options. They're going to produce energy, ATP, CO2, and water, or they're going to produce inflammation, which is lactic acid. Those are the only two paths you're going to go down. And we use body temperature and pulse to see this. Now, there's many factors involved in this scenario, oxygen, vitamin A, magnesium, light. That's why we use light therapy with people, etc. But one of the most important things besides oxygen is T3. Your cells use T3 to produce energy. T3 is like a hormone that revs your engine. It warms the engine up. This is why when people use sugar, carbohydrates, things like that, their body and temperature and pulse, it's more complicated, goes up because you're warming the engine up. So you have to think about what affects cell energy metabolism with cellular respiration. Now, according to Ray Peat, that's unsaturated fats, that's estrogen, that's prolactin, dioxins, radiation, things like that. Now, of course, his biggest one is unsaturated fats, because unsaturated fats have a similar action in the body as estrogen. Well, estrogen stimulates insulin. Estrogen wastes glucose, which we need to make thyroid hormone and upregulate energy production. Your liver is where you convert most of your thyroid hormone. You need selenium and glucose to do that. You have enzymes in your liver that are selenium and glucose dependent to convert T4 to T3. So there's many things that affect this. It could be a glucose insufficiency. It could be the food you're eating in the wrong frequencies. You're not teaching your liver how to store glycogen. It could be cortisol affecting T4 to T3 conversion. That increases reverse T3 and binds to the T3 binding sites, which decreases T3. It could be estrogen inhibiting the conversion of T4 to T3, halogens, mercury, bromine. It could be estrogen wasting glucose. It could be eating the wrong food ratios and releasing excess glucocorticoids, cortisol, and adrenaline. So this adrenaline, you know, will waste glycogen if there is any. So there's all these scenarios that can create this hypometabolic state. So for me, it comes down to how people are living. It comes down to the types of foods they're eating, the ratios of the foods they're eating in each meal, and the frequency that they're eating. Because if you eat the right foods that align with human physiology
and you eat them in the right frequencies, you can easily downregulate cortisol, adrenaline, estrogen, and all these things. So I think it's not one thing. It's really person-specific, because in some women, it's the inability to detox estrogen that's causing their, quote-unquote, thyroid issue. In some people, it's a mercury toxicity. In some people, it's a lot of the times, it's being hyperadrenaline and hypercortisol because they're not modulating stress with food in the right food frequencies. So I think there's many scenarios, but it's usually unsaturated fats, because unsaturated fats block glucose oxidation. So they block how sugars get into cells, and they block energy metabolism. So it's going to decrease energy production and lower body temperature and pulse. So there's all these different scenarios, but the one biggest thing you could do without getting complex with it is eat proteins that are anti-inflammatory, like whitefish, shellfish, broth, gelatin, dairy, and eggs. Use root vegetables because they're low in unsaturated fats and they're high in sugars. Use ripened tropical fruits because they have a higher saturated to unsaturated fat ratio. And eliminate unsaturated fats from your diet. Eliminate essential fatty acid supplements. Eliminate olive oil, fish oil, you know, above ground vegetables, vegetable oils, flaxseed, you know, safflower oil. Anything with any of those oils in it, start to eliminate them. Because according to Ray's philosophy, that is the biggest element that is going to inhibit, we could say, energy production and lead to this hypometabolic hypothyroid state. Does that answer your question, or did it go off on too many tangents?
Yeah, it did. Yeah, I mean, I think there's a lot of different things. So where should they go to research that? Should it be Ray Peat's website, or...
Yeah, I mean, there's you can, you know, for thyroid, I work with Rubin. He's got a lot of good books. You can study the work of Ray Peat. His website, he's got all his newsletters on his site. They're pretty technical, but you can start there. If you follow our YouTube and our blog and everything else, I mean, we talk about a lot of this stuff. You know, it's out there. But it's hard for people because they're so brainwashed. They're so brainwashed to believe that they can take a supplement and they're going to get healthy. So what I tell all my clients is, if you're not healthy, and obviously what you're doing is not working, you've got to make a change. You've got to stretch a little. And you get out of healing what you put into it. So start doing the research. Start doing the research and stretch a little so you can take yourself out of your comfort zone so you can actually heal, you know. And that's the bottom line.
You know, something that I find interesting is with watching some of your videos and things like that, maybe, I don't know, unfortunately, a lot of people, myself included, I read some of what Ray, has published, and I'm like, that just goes right over my head. I have no idea, you know, and it kind of discourages people from maybe doing some of the research. But your YouTube videos, in a way, it really helped kind of as an introductory level. Sometimes you really are able to bring it down to a comprehensible level, and then you go back and read something that Ray Peat's done, and it's easy, at least for me, to understand. But you know, one of the things that I like that you do is point something out, like salt. You have a video on salt, and you talk about, you know, so many people say, well, salt's bad, this is bad, whatever, but you break it down. Well, are you eating salt that is dyed and bleached? Or is it sea salt and things like that? So I don't really know where I was going with that. I just really like that you do that. I guess the perspective, and maybe you can disagree with me or not, but it's to look at the foods. Maybe these aren't bad foods, but they're just overly processed.
Well, it's a good point. And then it goes back to always asking the question, why? Everyone says saturated fat is bad. Well, what type of saturated fat are we talking about? That's like saying cars are bad. Well, what car are we talking about? You know, you have to get specific because you have coconut oil saturated fat, which is tons out there to show the benefits of it. And if it's going to kill you, then I'm going to die because we go through tubs of it. Or are we talking about the saturated fat that's in, you know, conventionally fed cows? You know, when people say salt is bad, first we have to understand physiology. And if we're talking about the dehydrated salt that's on a table, I agree. I can agree completely that it's bad. You know, are we talking about a Celtic sea salt? Are we talking about a Morton's pickling salt? That's completely different. So I think people have to get clear on what they're talking about, because a lot of what's out there is just way too generalized. And it's hurting people, because if you cut salt out of your diet and you understand physiology, that's one of the problems. Salt,
absolutely.
We promote people on a high salt diet. Does it cause high blood pressure? If it does, then I should have high blood pressure, because I eat anywhere from probably at least a tablespoon of salt a day easily. And I'm not saying everyone go do that, but, you know, we work with clients to work through this, and I'm not going to say it's the only thing that's going to help your blood pressure, but, you know, I think people are being misled because of they're not asking the why question. And you see this with pregnancy, with women that, you know, get, you know, preeclampsia and toxemia, and doctors say, we need to put you on a diuretic, you're so swollen. You know, cut out all the salt in your diet. The funny thing is, they actually need the salt, and that's the reason they're so swollen. They're so edemic. You know, so I think – go ahead.
No, go ahead. No, go ahead.
I just think people really, you know, it's like a client said to me the other day, my arm's killing me. I had to get a tetanus shot. My doctor told me I had to get one. I'm like, your doctor told you you had to get a tetanus shot, so you got a tetanus shot. You don't have to do everything your doctor tells you to. I think people need to really take control of their health and understand that they're the only one that's going to heal them, and they're the only ones that really understand them, and they have to make rational decisions instead of following what someone recommends. Because it's just hurting people. I mean, we have clients all over the world, and people don't just come to us. People say, I've worked with this doctor, that doctor, this person. I've spent $10,000, and I haven't gotten results. And we don't
That's why we're so glad to have you on the show right now. I mean, that's what we're trying to do, is promote independence, people, you know, to take responsibility for their lives. They own their lives, ultimately. You know, just for the average person that's listening to this, and, you know, maybe inspired, wants to start doing some research, what's some basic changes that they could make today in their diet that isn't going to discourage them too much or anything like that?
I think the first thing is, when you wake up in bed, take your body temperature and pulse, because that's qualitative. That's going to show you where you are. If your body temperature is below 97.8 when you're laying in bed, or below, I think it's like 36.4 Celsius. And your heart rate is like maybe, let's say, 40 or 50, you know, and you're laying in bed. Or even if it's like 90 or 100, you're in a hypometabolic state. That's not bad, though. You know now what you need to do or where you need to go. You need to go up. So from that point, you need to focus on, you know, you can go back to what I said on the certain types of foods. But one of the biggest things people can do is slowly eliminate all supplements, not medications, but supplements. Most of the supplements out there are crap, personally. That's what I believe. And start to work on not only the quality of food you're eating, but your food frequency. Food frequency is huge. Because if you're eating, we like to get our clients to at least 6 meals a day. That, when I say meal, it could be a snack, too. Because through doing that, and over time, we look at the ratios of carbs, proteins, fats in the meal, as well as at the end of the day. You can actually downregulate things like adrenaline and cortisol. You can regulate blood sugar. You can upregulate thyroid production. You can help the body detoxify, you know, estrogen. So food frequency is key. But if you want, log it. Go online, log it, to see how many calories you're taking in. Because most people that I work with, when they start logging and working with us one-to-one, like a lady I just started with yesterday, she's like, I'm eating a ton. Said, log your grams, send me your log. 950 calories. You cannot heal eating 950 calories. When the body wants to heal, it needs more energy. Typically, you need more calories, which is energy. So look at your caloric intake and slowly increase that to meet your metabolic needs, and you'll know if it's working because your body temperature and pulse will change. So I think those are some big things. You know, because it's going to create awareness around what you're doing, and that's what health is about. It's creating awareness. Probably the last thing, beside those foods, one of the biggest things that I like to see in people's diets, especially if they're making small changes, two things. And your meals always have carbs, protein, fats. You need all three, okay? But the last thing is, I like people to use bone broth or gelatin throughout the day for many reasons. But it's just, to me, a power food. There's so many anti-inflammatory qualities about it. If you make it at home, you know, beef bones, marrow bones, it's not pro-inflammatory. And it does so many different things in the body, from upregulating hydrochloric acid. It's loaded with glycine, which is beneficial for phase 2 detoxification, regulating blood sugar. It's an anti-estrogenic food, helps the body detoxify estrogen. There's just so many great qualities to it. So I'm a huge fan of bone broth. It's more than gelatin. But I guess those things would be the first things I'd start with and recommend people to do, you know.
Very good. Well, I just want to open it up. Brock or Jay, any final comments or remarks? Or Brock or Micah?
I was like, Jay, he's that, man, that's so interesting listening to all that. Because just kind of throughout the years, I've done, you know, your research kind of takes you to different places, you know, from primal diet, paleo diet, whatever, low carb, this and that, Atkins, you know, up to the Ray Peat thing. And it's so interesting. It's so contrary to what you hear nowadays. Like, it's just so different out there. And, I mean, even, like, there's this girl I work with, and she's studying nutrition at just a local university. And I try to talk to her about these things. I'm like, oh, there's nothing wrong with saturated fat. My coconut oil is great. You know, it's actually anti-inflammatory. You know, it'll actually reduce plaque in your arteries. And it's just like you said, Josh, people are brainwashed. I guess it gets quite frustrating. So the most you can do is just look after your, you know, start with yourself. Look after, you know, your health and your life and do your best to meet your needs. And I don't know, just even listening to what you just said, it's so fascinating that the body's such a complex system, yet the major indicator of health, at least in like the kind of the Ray Peat sector, is metabolic rate,
well,
you know, which is
your
body temperature.
That's a really good point, because I did a YouTube on it, and I called it Are You Healthy? Because it's people say, you know, I have abs, so I'm healthy, which I can't stand hearing, you know, or I lost 50 pounds, so I'm healthy, or I'm happy, so I'm healthy. The bottom line is this. With whatever you're doing, paleo, whatever diet it is, and this is how a lot of people say, well, you know, like nutritionists, coconut oil is a saturated fat, it's bad. We need to go on a low-fat diet. Paleos will say, you know, this is the diet because cavemen ate this way, which is a bunch of malarkey, you know.
Right.
All I say to them is, I don't really care the science behind what you're going to tell me. I don't even care about the science behind what I'm going to tell you. What I know is true is that we have a metabolic rate. Our cells produce energy or not. Your pulse is your pulse, your body temperature is your body temperature, and you can't argue what those mean. It's pure science. You literally cannot argue it. So I want you to do, and I did this with a friend of mine, who's paleo, super healthy, ripped abs, lost lots of weight. Wake up in the morning while you're laying in bed, take your body temperature and pulse. That's going to tell you if you're truly healthy from the inside out, not the outside in. Body temperature, 96.7 degrees, pulse, 38. He's lucky he's not hypothermic. So, to me, his diet is doing nothing to help his physiology at the cell level. It's doing everything to set him up for the diseases later on in life that everyone complains about. So, for me, it's that simple. It's really that simple. If you want to know if what you're doing is working, take your body temperature and pulse in the morning before getting out of bed. That is going to tell you if what you're doing is working or not, bottom line.
That's amazing. That's incredible. It's almost like the veil kind of over everybody's eyes. You know, there's this kind of this veil over everybody, and it's really that simple. The answer is that simple. It's just right there in front of us.
Well, they don't use any indicators. You know, nutritionists use the scale. Well, you know, I'm a big guy, and if I work out, I gain weight. I can gain muscle like there's no tomorrow, and my strength goes through the roof, right? So I paradigm my work. I periodized my workout. So 4 months ago, I periodized a plan, and yada, yada, yada. I gained 12 to 15 pounds, okay? But my pant sizes have dropped like 2 sizes. Wow. You get on a scale, I've gained weight. So for nutritionists, that would be, you know, horrible. So no one's really using any valid, you know, anything valid to say, are you healthy? Everyone's saying you lost weight, you're healthy. You know, as Diana Schwartzbein said, you actually have to get healthy to lose weight, not lose weight to get healthy. You know,
right.
People are saying,
That's interesting.
People are saying you have abs, so so you're healthy and you know what you're talking about. It's a bunch of bullshit, you know. There's a lot of people out there that are very intelligent, like Ray Peat. He doesn't have abs. He knows what he's talking about. So having abs is not a good indicator of health, you know. Of course, I believe mood and emotions are a good indicator. The bottom line is this, and I don't even believe a lab is a good indicator, personally, because I've had tons of people who, you know, have, you know, they do the what do you call it? They're like wealthy people, and they do these like big 2-day long health screenings, you know, that cost them like $5,000, you know, and they come back with this and that low, and they pay, you know, do supplements, but they'll come back completely fine, but they feel like shit. And you look at their temperature and pulse, and it doesn't add up because it's super low. So for me, it's cheap. You put your finger on your pulse, and you buy a $5 thermometer, if that. You don't have to pay a lot of money for it. You can do it 20 minutes after meals, in the morning, at night, and it's going to give you a true indicator of what's going on at the cell level. It's that simple. No one else is using anything. People are maybe, you know, like I said, how much weight are you losing? And, you know, did you fill out this assessment for the second time and your answer is different? I mean, there's just nothing qualitative people are using. So for me, body and temperature and pulse is where it's at.
Very good.
You know,
well, just,
wow.
Josh, real quick, I just wanted to ask you, it seems like everyone's popping these five-hour energies and all these different things constantly. And yes, they give them energy in the beginning, but they crash. Is there anything out there you'd recommend for anybody that wants sustainable energy that can just, so they don't fall asleep after work?
That's usually the types of foods and your frequency, because most people aren't eating enough. Food is calories. Calories are energy. Calories help your body produce energy. You know, so people are crashing usually from a blood sugar, you know, issue. So if you eat initially frequently enough, you regulate the amount of energy coming in, and you regulate how much glycogen you can store. And that's just really the problem, because most people have trained their bodies to not store glycogen. They eat once a day, two times a day, maybe three times a day. And there's a problem with that, because anytime you're stressed, whether you don't eat enough, you eat the wrong foods, you get in a fight, you're stressed at work, your body reacts the same way. It releases adrenaline to mobilize stored glycogen from the liver and muscles. The problem is most people aren't storing it. The body says, well, adrenaline did what it could, so now I'm going to release cortisol, which is a glucocorticoid, to regulate blood sugar. So cortisol is released, which demineralizes bone, inhibits thyroid production, increases blood sugar by breaking down proteins and fats through gluconeogenesis, but it's catabolic. In every sense, it's catabolic, the brain and the entire body and the bones. So it can easily create that hyper to hypoglycemic state. So you have to unwind that scenario. And the best way to do that is with the foods I mentioned. Most hypothyroid people compensate with adrenaline. And how do we downregulate cortisol? We do that with the right ratio of protein to fats with carbohydrates, because they're glucose. So, you know, food frequency and the right carbohydrates would downregulate cortisol. So we're not believers in the whole adrenal fatigue 1-2-3 thing. I think it's a completely made up, you know, philosophy. But if people regulate their blood sugar with food frequency, they can get out of that need for the five-hour energy thing, you know. Because for me, I eat 6 meals a day. I know my calories, my ratios. I have energy from the second I wake up to the second I go to bed. And if I tell people, all my clients, if I can do it, you can do it. It's, you know, I'm not anything special.
Well, Josh, I disagree. I think you're very special. The information that you're bringing to the table is very, very enlightening. It was a pleasure having you on. Go ahead. Can you give us some links where people can find you, how they can contact you if they're interested in your services, all that good stuff?
Yeah, if you go to our website, it's EastWestHealing.com, E-A-S-T-W-E-S-T, healing.com. If you go on in, you can find, you know, everything is on there. It's our website. Our blog's on the front page. You can click on the Metabolic Blueprint. That's our online educational program. We have a book, Metabolic Blueprint Cookbook. And then in the upper right-hand corner, you can do the little, you know, icons for, like, our blog talk, our YouTube, our Facebook, all that fun stuff. So you can literally find everything on our website, EastWestHealing.com.
Very good. All right. Yeah. Well, I encourage all the users to go and look Josh up, watch some of his videos, read some of his articles. Very enlightening stuff. Also, Ray Peat, I want to plug what he does at raypeat.com. Josh, thank you for spending your time. I know we went over, but great information. We hope to talk with you again real soon, all right?
I appreciate it. I'd love to come back on anytime.
Great, great. Any final parting thoughts or anything you'd like to say before you go?
I think the best plan when it comes to health is finding that right person and philosophy. You know, our slogan for our business is helping people to help themselves. So I personally believe that if you find the right philosophy or person, they're truly going to educate you so you don't need them anymore. And to me, that is really what holistic health or holistic health practitioner, that's what it's really about. Anyone that tells you what to do and selling you all this stuff, you're going to need them forever. And when you detach, you're not going to know what to do. So for me, it's about working with someone that's going to educate you so you can create your own journey and really empower. I mean, that's empowerment. That's what it's all about.
Absolutely. Teaching a man how to fish. Thank you very much, Josh. Thank you,
Brian, right on,
and Micah for coming on. Yeah, I appreciate it so much, guys. Also, please go ahead, take one video from Josh, his YouTube or whatever, and just post it on your Facebook, send it out on Twitter. Help get this information out there. I think it's really great. I mean, you know, like you were saying, it's not a cookie cutter way, but there's good information. We need to research it ourselves. We can't just, you know, go get a tetanus shot because we were told to. Let's pay attention to our bodies. So thank you very much again, everyone that joined on, and remember, own your life.
Thank you.
For seeking a healthier, safer, or simply a happier life, independence is the foundation. This doesn't mean you are alone. With our online community, you are able to exchange information with people who share your same desire and respect for self-reliance. Thank you for being a part of Unleashing Independence, the place where complaints are curbed and solutions are obtained. You can control your life rather than have life control you. UnleashIndependence.com. UnleashIndependence.com.